the esteemed correspondent Reverend Father William, the principal Dr. Maheshwaran, my beloved friend and the great academician Dr. G.M. Joseph Dunstan, the IQAC coordinator, esteemed professors of St. Saviour's Catholic College of Engineering and eminent personalities throughout the country, a very warm good morning to you all. Now, I would like to have the presentation on the topic NAAC Online Assessment and Accreditation Methodology in the Revised Framework. In the recent past, that means in the month of February, NAAC has proposed or published the quality mandate for higher education institutions in India. There in the preamp, they had given a statistical information about the universities, colleges and the teachers in our institutions or in our country. In the last 70 years, the universities have grown from 20 to 993, and the colleges have grown up from 500 to almost 40,000. Teachers have grown from 5,000 to nearly 15 lakhs, and the students have crossed 3.74 crores. So this is the present situation or scenario of our country. And if we think of the gross enrollment ratio, it is about just 26.3%. But the global trend is 54, or the average trend will be 36%, and the developed countries are showing 54.6%. You all will know that what is meant by gross enrollment ratio. That means the number of students entering into the tertiary education out of the total population in the age group of 18 to 23, and that is your gross enrollment ratio. So the NAAC and the higher education bodies in our country would like to increase it to 36%. And also, our National Education Policy 2020 recommends three types of institutions: the research intensive universities, teaching intensive universities, and degree granting autonomous colleges. So this is the main aim of the National Education Policy. So they wanted to achieve this within 2040. And this quality mandate for higher education institutions in India clearly tells you about all this aspect in 277 pages. And it was recently published in the month of February. If you go through that, you can see the importance of going for quality education in higher educational institutions. If you see this slide, here a overall picture had been given, how many institutions have been accredited as on 29/10/2020. This is the data collected from the NAAC website. Therefore, out of the 993 universities, only 364 have been accredited so far. And colleges, 8,166 have been accredited. And out of which, how many of them have got A grade, B grade and C grade is also shown in the next tabular column. Therefore, if you see this situation, how much effort is taken by the higher educational institution employers to achieve the quality education proposed by our country. In the future, NAAC accreditation is a mandatory for all higher educational institutions. Without accreditation, you can't get any grant from the UGC or from the central government or from the state government. So this NAAC accreditation is very vital in that aspect also. If you take the quality aspect in the global sense, that is also very vital. Therefore, all the eminent personalities who are listening to this or who have participated in this seminar should understand the importance of going for accreditation. If that's to be the case, what should be the eligibility to go for accreditation? For the first time accredited institutions, if the institution is going for first time, then the condition is stated in the first sentence. That is, at least two batches of students should have been graduated, or it should have been in existence for almost 6 years. And that is the criteria for going for accreditation. Any institution which had completed 6 years in existence and two batches of students have been graduated, then well and good, they can go for accreditation. For second and third higher order accreditation, the rest of them will be the criteria. That is, IQAC of the institution has to be very functional, and they have to submit the annual quality assurance report, AQAR, annually within the stipulated time. And if a particular institution wanted to go for second accreditation or third and so on, they have to submit the internal IIQA. And that IIQA should be submitted during the last 6 months of the validity period, subject to the fulfillment of the above conditions that had been stated already. Therefore, these are the criteria for going for accreditation. And now, if you see this one, what are the benefits of going for accreditation? From the different perspective, from the institution point of view, from the funding agencies, and from the society, and from the employers, what are the benefits of accreditation? If you think of the employer side, they will look for quality education offered to the students for prospective recruits. They wanted to take qualified and quality hands for their companies. Therefore, they are looking for educational institutions. This institution is providing a very good quality student, and we can recruit them. So in that aspect, and this accreditation is very vital in the perspective point of employers. If you think of the society, that means the parent side, the parents are looking for reliable information and the quality education offered. Out of the certain number of educational institutions, arts and science or engineering institute, which engineering college is providing a quality education? Which university is giving a quality education so that my son or daughter may be employed somewhere globally? So the parents and the society are thinking of this information. And if you think of the funding agency side, they are looking for objective data for performance funding. If you have got A plus grade, that institution which will get more funding from the funding agencies of the nation and also the companies. Therefore, that grade that you are getting, the quality that you are producing by the particular institution, is very important on the funding agency side also. If you look at to the institutional viewpoint, the institution can know its strength, weakness and opportunities available in our institution. They can identify the internal areas of planning and resource allocation. So this is the area in which we are strong enough. Therefore, we can allocate such an amount of money to that particular area. So they can identify the proper planning by observing our accreditation. And also, they can initiate, that means the management can initiate the innovative and modern methodology of pedagogy among the teaching community. So this accreditation gives a new sense of direction and identity for institutions. Apart from that, the institution can have an interaction with inter and intra-institutional interactions also. So all these are the benefits of being getting an accreditation. Therefore, NAC aims the following things. So after knowing the importance of accreditation, NAC aims to stimulate a particular environment in the institution to promote the quality in teaching, learning, research in the higher education. Therefore, accreditation promotes an academic environment of quality in teaching as well as in the research field of higher education. And also, the NAC aims to encourage self-evaluation accountability, autonomy, and innovations in higher education. Thirdly, NAAC aims to undertake quality-related research studies, consultancy, and training programs, and it also aims to collaborate with other stakeholders of the higher education institution for quality evaluation, promotion, and sustenance. So with these things in the mind, NAAC is coming for assessment and accreditation. With that purpose, the higher education institution and the government had given the free hand to NAAC to go through the NAAC assessment and accreditation. The NAAC aims the five core values. These are the five core values by which the NAAC assesses the quality of education, how a particular institution is contributing for the national development. So that is the first core value over which the NAAC will assess a particular situation. And the second point is the how the particular institution fosters global competencies among the students, how the student can compete globally. For all these things will be assessed in the core values. Thirdly, the NAAC assesses how a particular institution is inculcating value system among the students. If value had not been provided to the particular students, that will be a nuisance to the nation. Therefore, how a particular institution is promoting a value system among the students. Fourth, how the technology had been used effectively in the particular institution. Finally, the quest for excellence in the institution. Based upon the five core values, the NAAC is assessing a particular institution. And in 2017, NAAC had launched revised assessment and accreditation framework. In the earlier cases, we can say it is an analog one. Now, the new one, we can call it to be a digital one. That's why it is an ICT-enabled, objective, transparent, scalable, and robust. It is a very valuable method of evaluating, assessing the quality of education, or in other words, we can say how effectively the quality is quantized, digitalized. So this is not an analog method of assessment. That is, when we say analog, we can adjust plus or minus 20% from both sides. But here, there will be no adjustment. If they ask a particular question, that should be the answer. If you are not providing the correct answer, that will not be taken into account. Machine will quantize the values that you are providing to the particular question or particular metrics. And therefore, it was launched in 2017. Most of the institutions are finding very difficult to cope up with this method of measuring this assessment, because in the previous sense, it is very easy, it is flexible, it is adjustable, we can write down whatever we want. But nowadays, we have to be more specific, we have to be more particular, then only the NAAC will be assessed. Therefore, this revised assessment and accreditation framework is an effective method of assessing technical method. And here, in the second point, I am insisting, that is from the peer judgment to data-based quantitative indicator evaluation. That is, in the olden days, the peer team members will come and stay for 3 or 4 days and they will judge each and every metrics. But nowadays, most of the data, around 70% of the data, will be assessed in the digital system present in the NAAC office. Therefore, this is an ICT confirming scalability and robustness method. Moreover, this revised framework had reduced the number of questions drastically. The size of the report, previously one of the institutions had submitted 7 volumes. Nowadays, they are not going for 7 volumes, a few pages only. Therefore, there will be a drastic reduction in the number of questions and the size of the report and the visit days. And these are the overall picture about the revised assessment and accreditation framework. And the new concept that had been introduced is system generated score. If a particular institution scores 25% of the system generated score, then only the peer team will come and visit, and this is the pre-qualifier condition. So this pre-qualifier mode is introduced in the 2017 version. The system generated score, as I had already told, it is a combination of online evaluation, 70% online evaluation and 30% peer judgment. Another important aspect that had been introduced here is the third party validation. We call it to be VVV, validation and verification. Third party, the NAC will give the data to a third party, and that third party will assess data validation and verification. We call it to be DVV. This is a new mechanism introduced in the 2017 model. And if you are deviating very deeply from DVV, the credibility of the institution will be under question mark. Therefore, that is also more vital point. And similarly, the weightages given to the different metrics and the benchmarks that they had set up had been drastically changed. And moreover, it paved the way for the students and the alumni to have an enhanced participation in the assessment process. So these are the salient features of the revised accreditation process. NAC continues its focus on the quality culture of the institution. For that, for the first institution, if a particular institution is going for the first time, the NAC will look into the quality initiatives. What are the quality initiatives that had been taken place in the particular institution? NAC will focus only in that aspect alone. But for second and higher order accreditation, NAC will focus mainly on the quality sustenance and quality enhancement. How the institution is maintaining or sustaining the quality which already it had initiated, and what are the enhancement in the quality component, which whether it had been reflected in the vision, organization, operation and the process. All these things will be focused in the NAC assessment, and this assessment will be carried out in three stages. First one is SSR, self-study report, student satisfaction survey, triple S, we can call it to be triple S, and peer team report, that is PTV. So these are the main component or three stages by which this assessment will be carried out. While carrying out the assessment, the NAC will be assessing in seven criteria, assessing the particular institution under seven criteria. For the first institutions, they may be very clear about all these things. Curricular aspect, teaching, learning and evaluation. Like that, we have seven criteria. And these seven criteria will have several indicators, and that is given in the table. Curricular aspect has four key indicators. Under the each and every key indicator, we will have certain metrics. The metrics can be classified into qualitative metrics and quantitative metrics. Qualitative metrics will be assessed by the peer team members, and the quantitative metrics will be assessed in the NAC office itself, along with the SSS and the DVV and the system generated score. That will be done in the NAC office. For each and every criteria, the weightage is given in the last column. Therefore, this is for a PG institution. This will vary for autonomous institution, vary for UG colleges, and it will also vary for the universities. All these things will be clearly mentioned in the NAC manual. But what does this slide represent? The slide represents the data or the information for the PG college. For rest of the institutions, you can see the manual from the NAC website. Therefore, altogether, around 60 quantitative metrics and 35 qualitative metrics will be there for all the 7 criteria. And how this could be assessed, how we have to go about all these things, I will explain in the second part of my talk. And now here we can go to the next slide. There, what is the procedure that we are going to adopt, or the NAC is going to adopt? First one is the IIQA, that is Institutional Information for Quality Assessment. An institution which would like to go for accreditation should submit this IIQA, Institutional Information for Quality Assessment, online anytime during the year. There is no stipulated time. The portal will be open always. What we have to do, whatever will be the technical procedure and all these things, will be given in the manual. A particular institution going for the first time should have to register, and they have to get to the higher education link. Your institution has to be registered in the NAC, and you have to get a particular link, and that is your portal. Through that portal you have to enter, and there you will have a set of digitalized questions will be there. You have to give the information about your institution, all the data, right from the establishment and the statutory approvals, all these things you have to give, and your strength, your date of registration, your statutory rules and regulations, all these things, everything you have to give under the IIQA. And you have to remit certain fees also. The institution, the NAC, will go through the data, and moreover, all the data that you have given should be uploaded in your website. That's why that what I had given here. It is made statutory declaration on the institution website under section given here. Therefore, all the data what you had uploaded in your IIQA should be there in the website, because the NAC will automatically go there and verify whether what the data given by the particular institution is right or wrong. If you give a wrong information, or we can come the next time, if you have your institution is not eligible, then they will say your institution is not eligible, then you can reapply again and again, twice, with a single fee. After that also, if you are not eligible, then you are not able to submit for 1 year. After 1 year only, then you have to go for reassessment again. Therefore, with a single fee, you can reapply twice IIQA. And another aspect is, if you are giving wrong information to NAC, your institution will be debarred from appearing for NAC. Therefore, we have to be very clear in giving the data to the institution, to the NAC. Second one, you have to prepare the SSR. You have to upload the SSR in the portal of NAC website within 45 days of getting IIQA. If the NAC has given the clearance through IIQA, within 45 days, the SSR has to be uploaded. That means the SSR has to be prepared well in advance before going to IIQA. After submitting IIQA, if you prepare for SSR, then it is very difficult to upload your data. Therefore, SSR has to be prepared first. If it is completely over, around 90-95% it is over, then you have to go for IIQA. Before that, kindly don't go for IIQA before preparing SSR. And now here, how to prepare SSR, what are the criteria, what are the matrices, all these things we can go in the next episode. That means after this procedure, I will explain that preparation of SSR. To prepare the SSR, the NAC has given standard operating procedures. So based upon the operating procedure, we have to prepare SSR. This will be slightly difficult than the previous one. In the earlier stage, it will be very easy to prepare SSR. But under this revised framework, it will be a little bit difficult to prepare the SSR. And now let us see in the later stage. And the third one is, and here there are certain guidelines for filling up SSR or uploading SSR in the website. In the website, there will be some tool tips with a question mark at various places in the portal, such as metrics, submetrics, upload, etc. This upload limit is 5 MB for various matrices. For each and every matrix, imagine only 5 MB space will be given. So within that one, we have to upload the data. So according that, we have to prepare that one. And suppose if the data that we wanted to upload is greater than 5 MB, what should we have to do? We can upload it in our website and we can give the link to the NAC. Therefore, as far as possible, try to upload it within 5 MB. If it exceeds, we can upload it in our website and we can give the link to the NAC. Similarly, the data of the student survey has to be submitted concurrently during the online submission also. When you upload the SSR, the data regarding SSSS has to be given or uploaded in the SSR report also. Similarly, wherever asterisk red mark is indicated, it is mandatory, it is compulsory. So all these things are certain guidelines for uploading the SSR. And what is meant by DVV? Data validation and verification. The quantitative metrics will be subjected to validation exercise with the help of a third party. NAC will give the data to a third party and the third party will do this process. The third party DVV may ask for certain files. Then immediately you have to upload this data to the DVV and at the same time you have to inform it to NAC also. Without informing the NAC, you should not give it to the third party. Therefore, this is the criteria given by the NAC. Therefore, DVV is an important process by which the quantitative metrics, quantitative metrics will be assessed and it will be cleared by the pre-qualifier stage. If you get 25%, then only you will be eligible as a pre-qualifier one. Therefore, this will be assessed. This DVV will be done within 30 days. Within 1 month, they will complete the DVV exercise. And here, one point is so important. After DVV process, if the DVV report deviates from your data, that deviation report will be processed by NAC. The data provided by the particular institution should be concurrent with the data given to the NAC. It should be equal. There should not be any deviation. If there exists any deviation between the data, then action will be taken. That is very vital. HEI, whose metrics are found to be deviated, will be liable for the penalty or legal action fee. Action will be taken. Fees will also be forfeited. And your information will be given to the statutory authorities for further action. If you see the NAC website, you can see the list of institutions who have been debarred from this exercise. Because some of the institutions have done that also. Therefore, there should not be any deviation between DVV and the data provided by you. You have to be very careful in this one. Then, If an institution score at least 25% in the quantitative metrics, then only you will be qualified. If you have not get 25%, you have to apply for re-accreditation. You have to apply a fresh application only after 6 months only. If you have not been qualified under DVV, you have to apply afresh after 6 months only. So this is an important aspect of pre-qualifier stage. And the another aspect that had been introduced here is the SSS, Student Satisfaction Survey. While we are uploading the SSR, the institution has to upload the data of at least 50% of the currently enrolled students as per the template format of the Excel sheet given in the portal. So in the portal, there will be an Excel sheet format will be there. In that template, at the time of uploading the SSR, a particular institution has to upload 50% of the student data also simultaneously. And when this DVV process is going one side, on the other side, SS will also be carried out simultaneously. In the SS, they have 20 objective type questionnaire and one subjective questionnaire. The model questionnaire will also be there in the NAAC website. And this questionnaire will be emailed to all the students, and the following three rules will be followed for processing their responses. The data that you are providing should be accepted in the template given by the NAAC. No other template should be given there, because they had given certain columns there. All the data has to be given and no column should be left blank, and no data has to be re-entered again and again. All these conditions they have given here, there. Therefore, as I got stated here, no repetition of name, email address, mobile number is not allowed. You should not repeat. Therefore, this is the criteria they had given for SS, and this SS data has to be uploaded properly at the time of uploading the SSR. The NAAC will give the 20 objective questions and one subjective questions through email, and we have to inform the students about this accreditation process also, and we have to motivate the students to answer these email questions. If a particular institution's UG or PG or autonomous, the responses should be at least 10% of the student population or 100. If it is lower than this limit, this metric will not be taken for evaluation. For this metric, the score will be 60. If 10% of the student population had not answered for SS survey, then that component will not be taken. So this SSS will be completed within 1 month after its initiation. So within that 1 month, the student has to answer all these questions. And finally, as I had already told, DVV and SSS will be simultaneously conducted. And finally, the peer team visit, we call it to be PTV. Peer team visit of the institution should not exceed 3 months after the clearance of pre-qualifier stage. The number of days and the number of experts will be 2 to 3 days and 2 to 5 experts depending upon the institutions. The visiting team's role would be to assess only the qualitative metrics only. The NAAC will disclose the details of the peer team members only 3 days before the scheduled PTV dates. The modalities for the peer team members will be looked after by the NAAC team itself. We need not bother about their stay and everything. And after all these processes, the peer team will give you the report. The peer team report contains 4 sections. The first section will tell about the general information of the institution and its context. The second section tells a brief point about the criterion-wise analysis, which should be qualitative in nature. So they will give you a qualitative description about 7 criteria. The third section contains the overall picture or overall analysis of the institution, which contains the strength, the weakness, the opportunities and the challenges. And the final section of the PTV tells you about the recommendations, how you have to improve your quality in your particular institution. All this would be explained in the fourth section. And the NAC will give us a report that contains that PTV report. The second part of the NAC report is the graphical representation based on the system generated quality profile, and this will be in the form of a graph, and that you will get it when the NAC is sending the accreditation result. The third part contains the institutional grade sheet. This all together contains the NAC report that we will receive it from the NAC office at the time of awarding the grade. The above three parts will form together the NAC accreditation outcome document, and after getting this report, it is mandatory to upload this report in our website. So these are the stages by which the NAC is assessing the process. As I had already told, the system generated scores, the peer team report, the student satisfaction report, all this will be assessed, collated through an automated procedure based on the benchmarks. Based on the benchmark, that benchmark is very vital, which we don't know. The institutions don't know what is the benchmark set by NAC. They have not yet revealed that benchmark, and that is very important. So based upon the benchmark, all the data, all the report will be collated, automated on a 5-point scale. Finally, they would give the grade. The grade is shown in the table here. If an institution which gets above 3.51 to 4, it is A double plus grade, the status is accredited, and so on. If it is less than 1.5, the institution is assessed but not accredited. The institution is assessed but not accredited, that institution go once again for accreditation. If we have any clarifications or any doubt, if we are not satisfied with the grade provided to our particular institution, we can go for appeal also. Within a stipulated time, we can go for appeal. Because most of the institutions in the previous accreditation process would have got A plus grade. But in the revised process, they may go down either to B plus or B double plus. So they may be vexed with the grade. So they can go for appeal. Therefore, my point here is, it's very difficult to score higher points, to grade higher points in this revised accreditation. But anyhow, this is very vital. This is necessary for an institution to upgrade the quality produced or given to the student community so that our students can compete globally. Therefore, this is the method of going for NAS accreditation process. And the mandatory disclosure on the higher education institution's website, upload the SSR along with the relevant documents, create a separate NAC link on the website, and upload most of the documents. All the documents has to be uploaded in the NAC link. SSR submitted has to be uploaded after DVV process only in the PDF format. Data templates, the NAC had given certain data template to provide the quantitative information, and that has to be uploaded along with the SSR. Annual quality assurance report has to be uploaded every year, and accreditation outcome document certificate, grade sheet, everything has to be uploaded. Therefore, whenever we upload all these things, it should be there in the website, then only the accredited institutions or UGC or the funding agencies will look for the data. At that time, if you go for NIRF, they will go for the data. If the data is not there, you won't get a higher ranking in the NIRF. Therefore, this updation or uploading all the data in the website is very important. Now, let me go to the second part of my topic, that is how to prepare the SSR. How to prepare the SSR. This is very important, second part of my talk. Therefore, let us see. So there are certain general guidelines for higher educational institution. Only the original documents signed by the concerned authorities, means the principal or the correspondent or the secretary or the particular HOD. So the original documents signed by the concerned authorities should be scanned and uploaded. All the data should be like this. If you are getting some information from the registrar of the university or the vice chancellor of that university, the signature has to be there. Therefore, original documents signed by the statutory authorities should be scanned and uploaded. Second aspect, very important general guideline, is you should not insert the signature, or you should not insert your institutional emblem or letterhead in the document, will not be acceptable. Therefore, be careful in providing the data. So insertion of signature and the letterhead should be prohibited. For each metric, 5 MB data is allowed. If it exceeds, you can upload it in your own website, and we have to provide the link also. Data or the supporting documents should not be provided on Google Drive, Microsoft OneDrive, or Amazon Cloud, or any third party website. It should be in our own website. It is mandatory to fill all the templates in the specific formats provided by the NAC manual. So in the NAC manual, for each and every metric, each and every quantitative metric, and each and every extended profile, they had given the template. So in that format alone, we have to fill the data. To verify the data, we have to give the link. Therefore, data has to be given in a separate column, and the link has to be given in the separate column. So this is very mandatory. And it is also mandatory to respond to all clarifications raised by DBV for the items in the extended profile and metrics within the stipulated time. So if the DBV is asking for any clarification, suppose if you are giving the list of staff members, they may ask randomly the detail of one particular staff, then we have to provide that particular staff information to DBV. So this is mandatory. At that same time, we have to inform the NAC also before submitting the clarification responses to DBV. So whenever the data is voluminous, the DBV partner will seek for details from the selected sample documents for validation. And before submitting the clarification responses, the institution should report to NAC also. Any changes or additions in the data are not permissible. If the links and such changes in the documents will be tracked and it will be viewed seriously, which may lead to actions against the higher educational institutions. This is what, this is very vital. This had taken place in some of the institutions also. So we have to keep this in mind. Suppose if a document is in a regional language, that regional language document has to be converted into English, and that has to be properly signed by the head of the institution, and the translated copy as well as the original copy has to be uploaded. So original copy in the regional language and the translated copy should also, with the translated copy, should be signed by the concerned authorities, that is the principal, and then it has to be uploaded. Similarly, all the supporting documents, whenever we are saying these are the list of staff members, it has to be given the link. Therefore, all the supporting documents should be immediately uploaded along with the SSR, duly endorsed by the competent authority. And another important factor is geotagging. All the photographs should bear the date, time and the location in the digital camera. Without that, they won't accept it as a real data. Even if we give the data, the photograph, they will not consider it. Automatically the mark will be zero. We may be very happy that we had provided the data, but actually they had given they have programmed their computer in such a way to quantize it. If the date and the location is there, then it will be taken into account. Otherwise, it won't taken into account. Marks will not be given. Therefore, so now we may wonder how we can collect the data for the past 4 years with the data. We have not taken any photo like that. That's why we have to be ready in the earlier stage itself. From the beginning itself, we have to read all the manuals and we have to document it, everything. We need not take this one as an exercise now. We should not take it as a work now. This is a process. This is not a product. This is not a work that we can do hereafter. No, it is not a product. It is not an end. It is the process by which you are carrying out things. This is the way by which your institution has to function. At the same time, you have to document the data. Well, most of us won't take document the data. We will conduct some event. We won't document it. Or we would have thrown it somewhere else in the dustbin. Or we would have put it somewhere else. That is the mistake. Therefore, the way by which we have to run the institution is shown by NAC. That is very important. Don't take it as a new exercise, new work, interested upon the staff members, and we have to do this. If we take like this, we will land up somewhere else. Therefore, everything should be recorded then and there. That is the point we wanted to learn from this exercise. And now let us directly go to the 7 criteria with the basic introduction or basic idea or picture, clear picture what I had given to you. Now let us go to briefly, within a short duration, within half an hour or 20 minutes, let me explain all the 7 criteria of the SSR, how to prepare it, how to upload it. All these things I will reflect here. The first criteria is curricular aspect. The weightage is 100 and it has 3 key indicators for the PG institution. For autonomous as well as universities, there will be 5 key indicators. But for a PG institution or UG institution, we have only 4 criteria, key indicators. The first key indicator is curricular planning and implementation, which carries 20 weightage. So what is the significance of this curricular planning and implementation? What does NAC expect from you? NAC is expecting how the particular institution is planning the curriculum given by the university and how they are implementing it, how they are carrying out the things in the day-to-day affairs. This is what they wanted to assess. Therefore, how the particular institution is adopting the curriculum overview provided by the institution, by the universities. How the curriculum is operationalized within the overall framework, depending upon the resource potential, institutional goals and concern and so on. So depending upon your own situation, your own environment, your own potentiality, how you are implementing it. This is what the NAC wanted to assess. Therefore, how you are visualizing the things, how you are activating, how you are carrying out your activities, how you are activating, who is activating, who is carrying out the things, when you are activating the things, all these things they wanted to assess. Therefore, this process makes each institution unique. A particular institution may work in a particular direction, particular way. Another institution may execute in a different way. Therefore, this is unique for institutions. Therefore, the institution will be assessed in the curricular planning and implementation. So under this key indicator, we have certain metrics. The three metrics we have under this key indicator, curricular planning and implementation, we have three metrics, two qualitative metrics and one quantitative metrics. So the first qualitative metrics is this one, the institution, how does the institution ensures effective curriculum delivery through a well-planned and documented process, through a well-planned and documented process. So that documentation is essential. We may execute it, we can deliver it in a well-planned manner, but documentation we may be lacking. And we have to answer this in a descriptive way in not more than 500 words. So this is the question. Simply we can say question, or we can say it metrics. This is the measurement. The NAC wanted to measure your particular institution by this way, and they wanted to give 10 marks. Then what should be your answer? What you have to upload? Your response has to be written in 500 words. So if you can prepare it in your 500 words, you have to collect the data from all the departments of your institution. If you have seven department HODs has to submit a written report. The IQAC has to accumulate all these things, and they have to write it in 500 words, and they have to upload all the relevant documents what they have stated in the report. I had given a small guidelines here. The departments will have the departmental meetings to allocate the workload, to allocate the timetable and the planning for three internals. How do they deliver in the classroom and what is the monitoring mechanism? These 6 points I have given a small clue for you, which may be differing depending upon the institution. Therefore, this is only a small point or clue I had given. So this is the report by which you have to prepare the report, and for all these things you have to upload the timetable of a particular department, you have to upload all the documents, the monitoring mechanism, the delivery process. If you have a delivery process for a particular class in an engineering college, a particular teacher goes to the particular class and takes this portion. If you are recording all these things in a register or so, that has to be signed and uploaded. So that is what is their work allocation time, view document. That view document, you have to give the link. So what you have to upload in the SSR is the response in 500 words and the file description and the view document. Only this much alone has to be uploaded in the SSR. In the view document, you have to give the links, the web link, where the data is there. Suppose if you had uploaded the timetable of a particular department, then the link has to be given there. Then if you click it, we can say, oh, this is the timetable of EEE department. This is the timetable of the physics department. Like that, we can go for it. So this is the way by which you have to prepare this first metrics. And the second metric is another qualitative metrics. The institution adheres to the academic calendar, including the conduct of continuous internal evaluation. Whether the particular institution adheres to the academic calendar, Therefore, academic calendar, in the academic calendar, you have to print all the planning. This date, you will have the examination, first internal examination. This date, so-and-so will be having seminar. Like that, everything has to be put up on the academic calendar, and you have to upload the academic calendar for 5 years. Description, you have to write it down there. To execute the academic events, first internal test will be conducted on such and such a date. You will send a circular. That is called the additional information. That has to be uploaded there. Therefore, we can imagine that we can easily get to 5 marks. Unless or otherwise you upload all the documents necessary, we won't get to the 5 marks. Therefore, for all the 5 years, that is also very important. Therefore, this is the second criteria. And the third one is this one. This is a quantitative matrix. You carefully go through this one. Teachers of the institution participate in the following activities related to curriculum development and assessment of the affiliating university in the following academic bodies for 5 years. Whether you have been there in the following bodies, your staff members, academic council or board of studies, setting question papers, design and development of the curriculum for add-on courses, assessment and evaluation process of the affiliating university. If our staff members are in all the four, then your response has to be all of the above. If your staff members are in 1, 2, and 4, if it is not in 3, then any of the 3 above. So your response has to be any of the 3 above. Therefore, in most of the institutions, most of the staff members will be in all the 4 bodies. If that's to be the case, your response has to be all of the above. You will be given certain credit. But the second point is here. The participation of teachers in the various bodies, you have to prepare the list in a board of studies, so and so, so and so, so and so. You give the names list. In question paper setting, you write down the list staff name. And that is the first one, file description. This is the list of documents where your staff members are there. Then, for a particular staff, he may be in the question paper setting. He may be in the evaluation process. For that also, you have to give the linkage, and that is in the additional information. Therefore, some template had been given by the NAC for this question. In the manual, if you see there, you can see the questionnaire or the template. And this is the template, I hope, 113. This is the template provided in the Excel sheet by the NAC. Year, name of the teacher participated, name of the body in which the full-time teacher participated. Name of the body in which the full-time teacher participated. That is very vital. You should not include the part-time teacher. Therefore, this is the template. So this has to be prepared, and this template has to be uploaded in the first file description. Participation of teachers in the various bodies, view document. So this linkage should go to that template. This view doc, in the view document, you have to click. So when you click it, it will directly go to that template. Therefore, that template has to be uploaded. Inside the template, for a particular staff, if he had appeared for valuation, then that valuation order given by the registrar or controller of the university has to be uploaded. So this will come under additional information. Therefore, without any information, you see here, nomination letter for board of studies by the concerned statutory authorities, either by the registrar, and it should be valid for the assessment period. If it is beyond the assessment period or before the assessment period, that should not be taken into account. Then the letters that we are getting for setting the question paper from the control of examination, that has to be scanned and uploaded. Letters for design and development of the curriculum for add-on courses from the university or the affiliating university. Then the letters inviting the faculty for assessment by the affiliating university. DVV can seek document for the randomly selected teachers. And participation in other university not to be included. So these are the standard operating procedures given by the manual. If you can go through the manual and you can fill what are the documents that we have to give, what are the documents which are not valuable, that you can see from the standard operating procedures. So, okay, that is the first key indicator. So under the first key indicator, we have three metrics, two qualitative metrics and one quantitative metrics. Similarly, and how we have to answer it, all these things I got explained. Hereafter, when we go deeper into the SSR, I will not explain each and every one very deeply. Therefore, for a particular qualitative one, you have to write down a descriptive one within 500 words, and we have to upload all the documents necessary. For the quantitative one, the NAC has given certain templates, and that template has to be uploaded when you upload the SSR, and then the relevant document has to be uploaded. And this is the format that we have to follow hereafter. Therefore, with this in your mind, let us come to the second key indicator, academic flexibility. Under the academic flexibility, we have three metrics, which is given in the left side of your slide. Three metrics are there. Percentage of programs in which CBCS system or elective course system has been implemented. That is one quantitative metrics. Second one is qualitative metrics. I have given it in the yellow color, QLM. Third one is, once again, a quantitative metric. For all the quantitative metrics, keep in your mind, you have the template. Therefore, the template, percentage of programs in which choice-based credit system or elective course system has been implemented. For that, how to calculate, they had given a formula in the manual. Percentage of programs equal to number of programs with the CBSE or elective course system divided by total number of programs. If an engineering institution is running seven programs, in all the seven programs are CBSE, then 7 by 7 is 100. That's why I had given it as 100 there. Therefore, what is the document? What is the document necessary that you are running a CBSE? For that, you should have got some letter from the university. And that is the guidelines given in the right hand side. List of programs. List of programs you have to upload first. List of 1, 2, 3, 7 departments means 7 departments. So a list of programs in which CBCS in the last academic year certified by the registrar. You have to get the letter from the university. That letter has to be uploaded. And for autonomous institutions, suppose the universities might have circulated the board of minutes of the board of studies meeting to start the CBCS program. That letter or affiliating university letter stating implementation of CBCS or the structure of the program given by the particular university. Therefore, any one of the four can be given as a document. It has to be uploaded. Now going for the second one, number of add-on certificate programs offered during the last 5 years. If a particular institution is not providing add-on course or certificate programs, we are not providing a quality of education to our students. So apart from the regular programs, our students should have to imbibe certain additional skills, additional values, additional courses, additional knowledge also. Then only the student is a well-qualified person to compete globally. Therefore, qualification or the quality of education depends not only on the program you are running, it also depends on the additional courses or programs that you are providing to our students. That is also vital. And the second question and the third question are interrelated. Third metrics, average percentage of students enrolled. The second one is the number of add-on programs. Third one is average percentage of students enrolled. So the data will be given simultaneously to both. If you give data to the second one, it will also be applicable to the third one. So first you have to give the list of add-on certificate programs, name of the program, duration, the list of students enrolled, that term within the bracket is very vital, signature of the students. If you are running a program, if you are enrolling a particular student, you have to get the signature of the students. You should upload the curriculum of the add-on program. You should upload the assessment procedure. So all these things have to be uploaded. And after the completion of an add-on course, you have to submit a report. How you have run the program, how many students have participated, how it had been run, how you have evaluated, what is the use of it, whether we can change this add-on course for the next year. All these things should be given in the summary report. And that has to be uploaded. And year-wise list of students enrolled in the program. Attendance sheet of the student participating with his signature. Attendance, you have to get the signature of the student. In the online mode, we can go for another mechanism. But if it is in the offline mode, you have to get the signature. The DVV may seek for certificates of random selected students. The attendance document specific with for a particular date. For a specific date, you send the attendance. You have to send the attendance. And this add-on program should not be in the regular university curriculum. We should not say this environmental studies is an add-on course. You should not say that, because it is a regular environmental course. So this add-on course should be apart from the regular course. The certificate course should have at least 30 hours of duration. So this is about the second key indicator. The third key indicator is curriculum enrichment. Under this we have three metrics. One is qualitative, other two are quantitative. The institution integrates cross-cutting issues. How the institution is concentrating on cross-cutting issues such as professional ethics, gender, human values, environment. In the quality mandate, I told in the beginning of my session, in the quality mandate for higher education, Dr. G.M. Joseph Dunstan is an expertise in that field, quality mandate. There, they had given more specific to the ethics, gender, sensitization and human values. They are more about all these things. This is very vital. Therefore, what are the things that we can include? What are the programs that we can include? I have given it in the yellow color. Value education, human rights and social analysis, personality development, life skills, environmental studies, a certain clue, some pinpoints that I had given there. Therefore, these are the programs, these are the things that you can imbibe to our students. So these cross-cutting issues refer to the ability of the student to have a sufficient knowledge about all these things when they go to the society. When they choose the careers of their choice, when they go out of the institution, how they are competing, how they are behaving. Therefore, this is very vital. Therefore, this cross-cutting issues, how much importance we are giving. Whether nowadays our institutions are not bothering about all these things. We will teach only our curriculum provided. We are concentrating with the curriculum, horse eyes. We are not seeing this side or that side. So this aspect is also important, so that the quality will be improved on the student side. So that is the first question. Quality, we have to write it down in 500 words. The second metric is average percentage of courses that includes experimental learning through project work, field work, internship. Once again, I am stressing the point here. That is in the quality mandate also, the same point is given there. And now here, we can see how it can be calculated. Document showing the experimental learning through project work, field, internship should also be uploaded there. And now here, the third key matrix is how many students are going for internship. That can be calculated by the formula here. What are the documents that we can provide for all these things? The document should be the letter from the particular institution can be given there. So these are the few things for the key matrix, and the final key indicator under curricular aspect is the feedback system. And it has two questions, 20 marks, 20 weightage, and we have two metrics. First one is the institution obtains feedback on the syllabus and its transaction at the institution following the stakeholders. Whether you are getting the feedback from the students, teachers, employees and alumni. If it is from all the four, all of the above, we can get 20 marks. But this 20 marks will be, you can get the 20 marks if you are answering rightly in the second part of the matrix. In the second matrix, if you provide all the detail, then only you will get that 20 marks. Because we have to upload sample filled in feedback forms for the stakeholders. If you are answering A, all of the above, we have to provide 3 filled forms for each category. For students, 3 filled forms. Teachers, 3 filled forms. Employers, 3. Alumni, 3. Like that, we have to fill it up. So we have to upload it. The DVV partner may ask for filled forms for a randomly selected stakeholders. Feedback not related to design and review of the syllabus will not be considered. This is very important. When we say feedback, we think of the feedback about the particular teacher. We think of about the institution, the infrastructure facilities available about the institution, or other supporting services available about the institution. No, it is about the design and the review of the syllabus. This aspect is very vital. Some of the institution or in the previous accreditation, we can give any feedback. But now here, the feedback is pointing towards the design and review of the syllabus alone. Therefore, this is very important. And now here, how we have to we can go for the second matrix. In the second matrix, how the feedback had been analyzed. They have given 5 options. Out of the 5 options, if it is feedback is collected, analyzed, action taken, and it is available on the website, 4 points are there. Action taken means after getting the feedback, we have to analyze it and we have to come to a feedback report. And that feedback report has to be sent to the statutory bodies, to the university. Or if it is an autonomous institution, to the higher body. And there it has to be analyzed, and if you have to get an action taken report from the university. Therefore, a letter from the university has to be uploaded. All these things includes this one. Therefore, don't imagine that we can get easily, we can get 10 points here. No, it is about the syllabus, about the review of the syllabus. Therefore, we have to take much care here in bringing, in writing this answer. Therefore, this is about the first criteria. If you go for the second criteria, student enrollment and profile. Student enrollment and profile is the under teaching, learning and evaluation. This is the second criteria. Under the second criteria, we have the key indicator, student enrollment and profile. So here we have two quantitative questions, average enrollment percentage, average percentage of seats filled. How many students have been taken into the particular program? For that, what are the seats available, sanctioned intake from the government? And how many students have been admitted in the particular course? Similarly, how many seats have been filled as per the criteria? The letter that you are sending to the universities or to the higher bodies, all these things have to be uploaded here. That is about the student enrollment and the profile. For that we will be getting 40 marks. And the second key indicator is catering to student diversity. First one is a qualitative metric, second one is a quantitative metric. Whether the particular institution is assessing the learning levels of the students, whether the institution is catering the needs of the students, whether you are arranging the programs as per the learning levels or learning capacity of the students. And that is the qualitative report that you have to write it down in 500 words. I had given certain clues in the yellow line. You can conduct bridge course to bridge the gap between the students. To we can conduct the stream course to improve the communicative ability. You can classify the students as based upon their communicative English knowledge. You can separate the students in the stream A, stream B, stream C, and so on. And you can conduct a program for the students to improve the communicative ability. The learning levels could be assessed. For them, you can conduct remedial classes for the slow learners. Add-on courses for the advanced learners you can go about. So all this will come under the first key matrix. Then ratio of the student and full-time teachers. So we have to send the students a list also. Teaching learning process, this is very important aspect. Whether the learning is student-centric method is there. What are the learning, this is that you have to write it down in 500 words. How you are promoting the peer learning, what are the mechanisms that you are following, that you have to write it down here. And the second question is also a qualitative one. How you effectively you are using ICT enabled tools in your teaching methodology, LMS and e-learning resources, all these things, the relevant documents you have to upload in your website also. Mentor system, which is a quantitative one. The mentor list, the issues raised and resolved in the mentor system, all these things you have to upload in this matrix. The fourth one is teacher profile and quality of the teachers. How many of them are full-time? How many of them have completed their PhD? Average teaching experience and the relevant documents you have to provide here. The fifth one under this teaching, learning and evaluation is evaluation. Under evaluation, we have these aspects. Two, qualitative report. What is the mechanism available for internal assessment? Whether it is transparent, whether it is robust in terms of frequency and mode. All these things you have to give a write-up. The second question is, what are the grievances that you are facing? Sir, my result had not been published. My result had been withheld. They may say it orally. Get it in writing. Because we have to upload the document. and within the time bound period, whether you have solved all these things, this will be under the second qualitative metrics. And the next key indicator is student performance and learning outcomes. That is, we have very important aspect here, all the average pass percentage during the last 5 years you have to upload. And program outcome, course outcome, how it had been related. This topic would be explained about PO, CEO and everything in our next sessions, in our continuous sessions. You can clearly clarify the doubts about PO and CEO and everything. Your result has to be uploaded here. For that we have 30 weightage. Finally, the seventh one is student satisfaction survey, which I had already explained. In the third criteria, we have research, innovations and extension. Under this, we have the first key indicator is resource mobilization. The key resource mobilization, how much amount of money is mobilized by the particular institution. So that is more important. The grants received from the government and non-government agencies. E-copies of the letter of award has to be uploaded. The second quantitative question is percentage of teachers recognized as research guides. The approval letter from the university has to be uploaded. How many teachers have utilized the fund? The third key indicator. For that also, we have to upload the data. The second key indicator is innovative ecosystem, which first one is the qualitative one. The institution has created an ecosystem for innovations, incubation center, center for biodiversity, center for aquaculture, research and extension. Likewise, this is some of the clue that I had given. It's my viewpoint, not from the NAC point. So all these things could be easily added there. The second quantitative metric is what are the number of workshops and the seminars conducted on research methodology, IPR and entrepreneurship. Only related with research methodology and intellectual property right and entrepreneurship seminar should be included here. The standard operating procedures, if you see what are the things that we can include, what are the things not to include, all these things will be there in the innovative ecosystem. And the third one is research publication and awards. Under the research publication and awards, we have three quantitative questions. The number of PhD registered, number of papers published, number of e-books or conference proceedings, that we may be familiar with all these things, the data has to be given there. The fourth one is extension activities, how the extension activities are carried out in the neighborhood community during the last 5 years. 5 points. The number of awards and recognition received for extension activities. This is only the award to the particular institution, not individual award should not be included here. And under NCC, NSS, Red Cross and everything should be included here. And the students' participation list has to be provided under this one also. Finally, the final key metrics is collaboration. Number of collaborative activities for research, faculty exchange, student exchange and internship. This is between the institution. If a particular staff is doing a collaborative research in a particular research center, a tie-up should be there between the two institutions. It should not be between individuals. That's why certificates issued by external agencies to students or faculty cannot be the proof. It should be between the institutions. Then only it has to be included here. Similarly for MOUs also, between the institutions, we should have an active MOU. If the MOU is not active, it should not be included there. Certain criteria will be there. You can go through that one also. The fourth criteria is infrastructure and learning resources, physical facilities available. Infrastructure and physical facilities, classrooms, seminar halls and everything will be under the first one. Facilities for cultural sports and games under the second one. And how effectively all the classrooms and the seminar hall has been, seminar classrooms have been used. For that, we should have a geotagged photographs of ICT-enabled classrooms. How many classrooms have been ICT-enabled? How many classrooms have been ICT-enabled? One important point is labs and workshops with ICT facilities not to be considered here. Only classrooms and seminar halls should be included there. What is the amount that you have given for providing that ICT facilities for augmenting in during the last 5 years to augment the classrooms? How much amount you have spent there? You have to give the audited income expenditure statement highlighting that statement, that expenditure. The second point is library as the learning resource, ILMS should be there. If no ILMS, automatically they won't give any marks. Similarly, e-copy of the e-resources available, e-source in the InFlipNet, everything, whatever the facilities, everything should be given there. An annual expenditure for the purchase of books. So here also we have to give the income expenditure auditor statement signed by the consent authorities highlighting the expenditure towards the books. Similarly, percentage per day usage of library by teachers and the students, certified screenshots for the same days, e-copy of the ledger for footfalls for 5 days, everything should be given there. The infrastructure facilities available there, the Wi-Fi facilities, IT facilities, number of computer facilities available there should be provided under infrastructure. Maintenance of campus infrastructure, how much amount of money is spent about the physical academic support facilities, maintenance of laboratory, library, sports complex, computers, everything, auditor statement highlighting it, everything we have to include here. So this is about the fourth criteria. Under the fifth criteria, we have the student support and progression, 130 weightage. The first key indicator is student support. What are the support facilities available for effective learning? Say for example, scholarships and freeships from the government, from the institution. The first criteria is from the government. Second criteria is from the institution. For the government, you should have the sanction letter. From the university, from the particular institution, we should have the audited statement highlighting how many students have been benefited from out of that. In the second criteria, we have, in the first criteria also, we have three more quantitative metrics: capacity building and skill enhancement initiative. What are the measures taken by the particular institution for capacity building? What are the programs that you are running? What are the various activities that you are conducting for the students? All these things will be under capacity building. What are the guidance available for the competitive examination? What are the relevant mechanism available? All these things we have to give here. And under the student progression, higher studies, how many of them are going for higher studies? All these things you have to present here. And in the third key indicator, whether how many students have been participating in the activities. There you have to include here. Alumni engagement, it has to be a registered one and they have to contribute in lakhs. In the sixth criteria, governance, leadership and management, we have institutional vision and leadership, strategy development and deployment, second criteria, and faculty empowerment strategies, what are the welfare schemes available, faculty empowerment strategies, all these things comes under the sixth criteria. There you have the quality insurance, quality assurance system, and the final one is institutional values and best practices, promotion of gender equity, alternate source of energy, waste management, waste conservation facilities, green campus, quality audits, disabled friendly environment, inclusive environment, constitutional obligations, what are the programs that you are conducting, all these things. And finally, you have to write down two best practices by the institution and institutional distinctiveness. I hope that I have covered all these things.
இந்த வீடியோ உங்களுக்கு பிடிச்சிருந்ததுன்னா லைக் பண்ணுங்கள், ஷேர் பண்ணுங்கள், கமெண்ட் பண்ணுங்கள். இதே மாதிரி இன்னும் நிறைய வீடியோஸ் பார்க்கணுன்னா மறக்காமல் டார்ஜில் லேர்னிங் ஹப்பை சப்ஸ்கிரைப் பண்ணுங்கள், அந்த பெல் ஐக்கானையும் ப்ரெஸ் பண்ணுங்கள்.